Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we are going to look at how to interpret integration in the proton NMR. Integration is one of the pieces of information that a proton NMR gives us, and it's literally just a measure of the area under the peak. So it tells us the relative amount of each unique type of proton. So if we label our protons HA, HB, HC, it tells us how many HAs there are relative to HB. So let's go to the next slide. We'll draw a molecule and we'll look at what we would expect to see. So here we have a molecule. If you haven't already learned how to label unique protons and to predict splitting patterns, you should watch those videos first, because we're going to assume that knowledge as we go on here with integration. So I have three unique types of protons. That means I would expect three signals. I now know how to predict splitting using the N plus one rule, so I know what they'd look like. So let's start with HA. HA would be a triplet because it has two neighbors. Now let's go on to HB. HB would be a quartet because it has three neighbors, those HAs. And then lastly, I would have HC, and that would be a singlet because it doesn't have any protons on the neighboring carbon atom. So when we say neighbors, we're referring to the number of neighboring protons on that carbon atom that's next door. So I have three peaks in this spectrum, and when I work up my data, I would tell the computer program to integrate the area under the peak so I could know the relative amounts of each type of unique proton. So there are three HAs, so if I integrated the area under that peak, I could set that value equal to three. And then when I did that, my HBs, of which I have two, would have an integration of about two. And then HCs, of which there are also three, would have an integration of three, okay? So we're using whole kind of pretty numbers right now. The relative ratio is three HAs to two HBs to three HCs. When you tell the computer to actually do this, it's just gonna give a number, and then everything else is gonna be relative to that. So I'll show you next what to do if you just have sort of raw data and you haven't calibrated the integrations to be equal to a certain number of protons. Here I've sketched an NMR for the molecule shown above. It has three unique signals, and so you see each of those signals. The one part we haven't covered yet is the chemical shift, so that's in a different video, but you'll see that these signals are placed on the actual NMR spectrum at particular chemical shifts here. So between 0 and 3 parts per million is the chemical shift range in which all of these signals would show up. So I've sketched what an NMR for this would look like, including integrations, and I've just put numbers on there, but the numbers haven't been calibrated. And unless you tell the computer that some value is equal to a certain number of protons, you're just going to get numbers that look like this. So if on a homework program or in the laboratory you take an NMR and you get numbers that look like this, what you want to do is look for the smallest number and divide by that, okay? So my smallest integration value here is 32. So I'm gonna take 97 and divide by 32, and that gives me about a ratio of 3 to 1. Now in an actual experimental NMR, the integrations are not gonna be perfect. There's often impurities, or maybe the baseline on either side of your signal is a little bit wonky, and when that occurs, it doesn't give you perfect numbers. So if it's about a whole number, that's likely the right integration. So if I take 200 and I divide by 32, I get about 6 to 1 ratio. So this information tells me that I have one HB for three HAs for six HCs. So the numbers aren't going to be perfect, but they're going to be close. And if you divide by the smallest integral value, then you can find the relative ratio pretty easily that way. So in this example, I have another molecule. This molecule is symmetrical, and I have two signals because of that symmetry right down the middle here. So you have HBs on either side of the oxygen directly, and then HAs on the exterior there. And the computer, again, will have integrated, and you haven't calibrated that integration. And so you're going to take your biggest value and divide by your smallest value. And in this case, that's gonna give you a ratio of 1.5 to 1. So it's not a whole number ratio. I can't have half of a proton coming off of a carbon. So when you get a fraction like that, you're going to multiply by some factor to get to a whole number ratio for your protons. So if I multiplied by 2 in this case, I would get a ratio of 3 to 2. And you can see from our structure that the relative ratio of HB to HA is 2 HBs for every 3 HAs. So in reference to this last example, I want to point out that we're getting a relative ratio, not necessarily the absolute number of hydrogens on our molecule. So many times you'll be solving a problem where you just have a chemical formula and you don't have any other information. And so if I just have a chemical formula, I see that I have C4H10O. My total integration, given the values that I just calculated, is 5, right? So there's 3 HAs to 2 HBs. That's the relative ratio. If the total integration comes out to be only 5, but I have 10 protons, then that tells me I need to multiply by 2. And having few signals but lots of protons tells me that I have symmetry in the molecule. So that may be one thing to check when you're solving a problem. Does your total integration equal the number of protons that are in your formula? And if it doesn't, that implies that there's probably symmetry somewhere in the molecule. So the last place that you may see symmetry indicated is when you have large integrations. So any integration over 3 is going to imply symmetry because you can't have more than 3 protons on a carbon atom that's connected to something else, right? So if you see an integration of 6, that's a multiple of 3, that indicates methyls that are in the same chemical environment. So a common way that we might see that is the isopropyl group. So these 2 methyls are in the same environment. You could even see an integration of 9 if you had a tert-butyl group. So all of these 3 methyls are coming off of the same carbon atom, so they're in an identical chemical environment, and they would give you a large integration of 9. You could also see symmetry with CH2 groups in the same way. So if you had CH2s coming off of the same carbon atom, so this would be like a diethyl group, those 2 CH2s would be identical with respect to chemical environment, and so they would have the same chemical shift in an integration total of 4. Right? Or we just saw the example with ether where you have a mirror plane down the middle of the molecule. And so those 2 CH2s are in an identical chemical environment and they would have a total integration of 4 as well. So it's probably less likely to see symmetry when it comes to CH2s and integrals of 4, but you can see it. And so it's good to be aware whenever there's an integration higher than 3, that does imply symmetry. So that is a quick lesson on how we can use integration to inform our structural determination when looking at a proton NMR. If you found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends, and I'll see you next time.